Hello, good evening, everybody. I'm glad that you're here. Michelle had asked me to come and talk to you about empath, how it affects me. So I will start by saying that I am an angel card reader. I work with archangels and have been doing this for 7 years plus. I have clients who come to me if they are struggling with something that is ailing them. I also help with people who have loved ones who've crossed over, so I can connect with them too. And they have free will choice, just like we do. So not everyone always comes through, or the person that they think is going to come through. It depends on what the realm above has given me to help them. I am also a Reiki master and a chakra balancer. I also just got my medical Reiki, so I can help people in the hospital if they are under duress or they have to have surgeries or whatever the case may be. I can be there for them to support them and aid them. Okay, so today, how does empath work for me? Let's start by saying the clairs, claircognizance, clairsentience, clairaudience, and clairvoyance. We'll start one at a time. The first one was claircognizance, knowing without knowing how I know things. It started when I was a little girl, and I thought everyone, as a little girl, I thought everyone had these gifts, what I had, and found out very quickly in school, in elementary, I was like alone. There were things that happened and not all the kids had what I had. So I became introverted. And I didn't talk to my parents about it, and I didn't share it with my younger brothers. And when I got to be a teenager, clairsentience came in. Now, clairsentience was showing me negative energy, and I didn't know what to do with it. So that even made me more guarded, more closed than I was before, and it made me angry. Because I didn't know who to talk to about it. I didn't know where to go with it. And I just kept it all in. And that's the worst thing to do. Of course, when you're a kid, you're not sure what to do. And with being a teenager, you're going through your changes and you don't want to deal with it. Fast forward to in my 20s. I had a car accident. I died twice on the helicopter ride. And I died again in the hospital 2 weeks after I was there. And I was there for 4 weeks. In the hospital, on the third time that I passed, I crossed two realms. I crossed to Hades first for 3 days. And then I crossed to heaven. When I crossed to heaven, it was into the light. But I didn't get through the gate. Because Christ came from the light to let me know telepathically that I was not supposed to be there. I had not finished my path of enlightenment here on earth. I was going to be helping many more people than I could have ever imagined. So with that, that's where clairsentience started changing around. I started accepting positive energies and not just negative. And part of that was because I was praying, how come you're telling me I have to deal with negative energy, but you're not showing me the positive energy? And it was because I was blocking it. So I had to learn to open up. Then clairaudience came in my 30s. When I hit my 30s, I came into a very peaceful time. And I thought, wow, this is really great. I'm like, how come I didn't have this euphoria before? And I was single. I didn't get married. I didn't have my children. And I just thought, wow, this is really amazing. I want more of this peacefulness. And clairaudience opened. Now, I'm going to ask a question with all of you. Have you ever had a pop-up music in your head? Yes? No?
Yes. Yeah? The earworm?
A music will just pop into your head and you're like, okay, where did that come from?
A song. A song pops into your head.
Mm-hmm. Well, at the time, clairaudience opened, but I didn't recognize it. And if you have heard this, it's already opening for you and you didn't even know it. Because now it's a little bit different. It's not like a pop-up in the head. It's almost like somebody's standing at my right ear with a megaphone and starts singing into my ear. And it won't shut off and it won't change the dial. It'll just keep right on playing until you accept it, or at least till I accept it. And then I have to figure it out. Why is this song coming to me? Is it for me? Is it for somebody new I just met? Or is it somebody I've known and they need the message, or a new client's coming? So I have to figure it out. Okay, so that's clairaudience, a hearing. Clairvoyance opened a couple years ago, and it was through a friend whose name is Keith, ironically, and I've known him for more than 20 years. And I found out over time in the last two decades that he's not only my soulmate, he's also my twin flame. And we had shared lifetimes together before, and we're going to be working again together in this life. And chances are, if that's true, that means if we were to come back to Earth again after crossing over and coming back, I would probably be with him again. Okay? It's just, what role are we playing this time around? I want to back up because Keith is very important into my life because of several different factors. One, it hits the stage about the clairvoyance. It's in its infancy. And if anybody has ever seen Tyler Henry on TV, the young kid who's got clairvoyance, who uses writing, he scribbles on paper to get information. And Teresa Caputo, the Long Island medium, if you've caught her, she has clairvoyance. She opened her gift. She was wide open when she was a little girl. Scared her when she was little, but as she got older, she embraced her gift and she knows how to use it well. Because now she's going all over the country, okay, helping hundreds of thousands of people. And for me, opening up to clairvoyance was a sign, a symbol. And the symbol that came to me was a right hook to my face. And it was at the 3 o'clock in the morning hour, which is called the witching hour, where things can come to you like you wouldn't believe at that hour. And I think the three is very important because the three stands for masters of the universe. Okay, so before I go to sleep, I say the Father's Prayer, I say the Serenity Prayer, and I say Mother Mary's Prayer. Even though I'm not Catholic, I wasn't brought up in a church. I did get baptized at 19. I was baptized in a non-denominational church, and I was baptized in a creek that was right beside it. I know before I went into the water and came out, I was not the same. Instantly. So the clairvoyance opened up to a fist, and it was a right hook, and it was Keith's ring that was his initials, KEG, done in diamonds, and the E was heightened. There was a line under it. And I knew that Keith's middle name was Edward, and from that point on, for 9 long days, I had information coming in. Okay, it was almost like somebody tapping you on the shoulder. I'm trying to get your attention. Okay, you got my attention. What do you need? And I'm saying this as if somebody's sitting next to me and there's nobody physically there. But I know they're there because I have clairsentience. Out of all of those clairs, my strongest one is feeling. That's what clairsentience is a deep-seated feeling. You know if somebody's around you. You know if somebody's bumped your energy. That you know if somebody gets inside of your energy. Okay, I feel it like temperature changes drastically. I can go from a high where I'm sweating my ass off, and I could go to an ultimate low where I'm freezing to death. My hands are like ice. You can touch.
Yeah, they are.
Okay, so it's not that I'm nervous or anything, because some people would think that would be a nervous twitch or whatever. But no, I'm feeling energy around. I'm picking it up. I'm absorbing some of it. I'm not absorbing all of it. I'm just taking it in and feeling you out. That's all I'm doing. Now, if I start to get really warm, this tells me that I have an angel who's just stepped right between you and I. Because now they're in my comfort zone and yours too, if they're standing right here. And they are so powerful. Angels are so powerful. It feels like they wrap wings around you. Now, to make you understand what this feels like, take a blanket that's been in the dryer for a half an hour. And you know how warm it was outside before you came in? Take that blanket and go outside. Do you think you'd be a little warm with the blanket around you with 78 degrees outside? Okay, that's what it feels like for me. It gets so intensely, but it's not like a sweaty hot because I'm going through menopause and I know what that feels like. But it's a dry heat. It's almost like you're in Texas. It's almost sweltering. It's hard to breathe when they're around. So what I have to do is telepathically is tell the angels, you need to step back or you need to step outside of my comfort zone. I love you. If my clients see me do this, they don't understand why I'm blowing kisses, but I'm telling them I love you very much. I'm so glad that you came, but you are overpowering me. You need to get outside of my comfort zone. Now, does everybody know how big your comfort zone is? Your comfort zone is if you extend your hands out wide and you draw a big circle around you. That's your comfort zone. If somebody gets in your face and they're within this distance, they're too close to you. If they're upset, make sure that there's distance between you and them. About the clairvoyance, it's such a powerful modality that you carry from within. How many people believe that you have one or more than one? I just named four. There's more than four, actually. How many of you believe that you carry one of these clairs? Just one of you think so?
Oh, absolutely.
You do. You do. That's right. All of you do carry all of them. The only difference between Michelle and I and all of you is we put it into practice. That's it. I wish it were harder than that, but it's not, is it? It's not that hard. We have to practice it just like anything else that we learn in this life, how to hone it. Accept it and learn how it works for you, because everyone does a different job. And just because what I'm explaining to you doesn't mean you have to do what I do. You find it within yourself what's going to be beneficial for you, and then you apply it how you feel you should use it to help another person. Okay? Now, the clairvoyance is very, very important, even though mine is mostly clairsentience. Is the clairvoyance works with the third eye chakra, and Michelle had made a comment earlier that we don't use but a portion of our brain. Well, that's because we don't reach up high enough. I did this earlier. I'm way up here all the time. It's because I want my level to be higher. It's okay to come down to somebody else's level because they're learning, and in order to come up the ladder, we sometimes have to pull them up to get to where we are. But they can't jump the rung. If you were looking at a ladder, they can't jump a rung to get to where you are. It takes them one step at a time, one rung at a time, to get them where they need to be. And that's all of you. All of you are here because you want to know how to get up to the next rung on the ladder. That's why you're here. And you can do it. That's what I'm here to tell you. You can do it. And if you can do it, you know you can empower someone else to do it too. Now, some of you may be struggling with, you know, the ego. The ego, we discussed this earlier. The ego is up here in the head. It's never here in the heart. The heart is always clear because our spirituality shows us and tells us how we're supposed to be naturally. That's the super subconscious. They know right from wrong, and they will never misguide you. It's this that misguides us. It's our head. And we want to know things, and we want to do things, and sometimes we get into the wrong thing to do, and we have to not do it again. Those are the mistakes. Those are the errors. But if we can learn to teach the ego, it's not a terrible thing to have an ego. I learned this like 2 years ago. I was like, what? Wait, I told the ego to get in the back seat or get out of the car. You know, if they get too far ahead and they're not in the right frame of mind. But I didn't realize that the ego is something that you're built with as a human body, and it's there for protection. Really, it's from the root chakra. It's got to be there because we learn how to protect ourselves, even if it's at its own extreme problem that can arise. Like if somebody were to threaten your life, are you going to stand there and let them kill you, or are you going to fight back? I'm just using that as an example. That's the ego. We have to have an ego to a certain degree, but we have to recognize that the ego is not always right, and it needs to take a back seat or get out of the car. That's how I look at my ego. I didn't ask you to get in the car, and you're definitely not going to get in the driver's seat. You know, I want to have total control over that, not it controlling me. Does that make sense? Okay. Okay. Now, the clairvoyance is about the third eye chakra. Most people have this area closed off. Okay. Yep. And with the third eye chakra, if we can learn to open this, we can see. Not with our naked eyes. We see that the universe wants to give us information, but we're too blasé to accept that and close it off because we're afraid. And fear is nothing but fear itself. If you don't feed the fear, you starve it. If you feed the fear, what happens? We make that fear into a big monster. And what happens with the monster? It demands more. And it gets bigger. And we don't want that. We want no fear whatsoever. Clairvoyance is a very important step to our higher conscious state. And if we can learn to tap into that, we will be marvelous at what we decide to do in our lifetime. It's up to us. We have free will choice. Now, I want to finish this by sharing with you. You can take your gift and open the box. No, leave it on.
Yeah.
Yep, leave it on. I have a lot of clients who've come to me and said, you know, everybody feels when I tell them what clairsentience is. And I said, well, my clairsentience is a little bit more stronger than yours because I practice it. Didn't I say this a few minutes ago? Because we don't practice enough. Now, I want you to take one of the longest strands, one of these longer ones, and make sure that when you put it up on your head, you want to make sure that it's going to hit the very back center of your head. Are we ready? Get set. Go. All you do is just slide it right down.
Oh, that feels so weird.
Oh, I see.
How's that feel? How's that feel? It's pretty freaky, isn't it?
Feels good.
Yes, it does. Very good. I want you to know that I used to suffer headaches a lot, okay, before my accident. After my accident, I started getting migraines. Well, a few years ago, I got one that was wire with a copper handle. And let me tell you, I started using that thing right before, if you could feel a headache coming on, you just put it right back, you put it on your head.
So you go like that?
Mom, it's your cure.
Can you move it?
Just take your handle and push it right down to your head.
Push it right down?
Yeah, push it right down.
Oh my God.
It's a lifesaver because I'll tell you what, tonight I've been having it off.
Because I'll tell you what, I guarantee if you start to get a headache, put that, this is the greatest tool you could ever own. Because
it's getting the circulation.
It's moving. Yes, what's happening. And the next time we have a group reading,
yeah,
I'm going to bring another thing that most people, children use, but I want it to be a surprise. I don't want it to break the surprise. I have another surprise for you, but it'll have to be for the next meeting.
Wow.
And
oh my God, my wedding now.
Because of what I just told you tonight with your arms extended with the circle around you, we'll talk about that a little bit more in depth with the next thing that I bring. Not that I'm going to share it with you, but you can't take it with you. And so anyway, I wanted to share this with you because this will show you what a beautiful tool. If you're not feeling good and your head needs something, you know, did you ever like walk around going, oh, I'm just so like out of it. What is wrong with my head today? Put that on your head for 5 minutes. I guarantee after 5 minutes, and don't think about anything. Just massage your head. What's happening is all the neurons are being stimulated in your brain. Stimulated. And all it takes is up and down. That's it. All these little wires are connecting. And they're saying, ooh, I like that. That's what your brain is saying. Ooh, I like that. I want more.
Give me more
of this. Because this is what I feel. Welcome to my world. I feel this all the time.
Instead of grabbing a bowl of ice cream, do this instead.
That's right. Absolutely. Well, no, I'm saying for your head, honey. It's for your head. It's a head massager, and it's there to stimulate the brain because it's either burnt out or the brain is just overloaded. I don't know how many times I've written, because I'm writing a book too. I'm going to be an author. It's called Universal Links, about my whole life, what it's like to be in my body, in my mind, and in my spirit all at the same time. And of course, there's going to be a lot of emotion in it. It's going to be like a roller coaster. You're going to laugh. You're going to cry. You're probably going to be pissed off. And you're going to probably be like elated, like, holy crap. How does this woman have this whole entire life all in one? If that's what I can teach my reader, holy crap, what can I teach themselves when they get done with it? You know, because everybody has a story to tell. Everyone has something to share. It's how you put it out there. So has everyone taken something with them tonight?
Any questions?
Questions? Bella? Any questions? Wow, everybody's
all
like,
oh. We don't know what to ask her.
All right, let me undo this.
Okay, there you
all
go.
All right.